Hello friends, today we'll be discussing on DC generator construction. The basic parts of a DC motor and generator used in the construction are the same. So the construction of DC generator also covers the construction of DC motor. In the construction of a DC generator used in the industry, there are these essential parts. Number 1. Magnetic frame or yoke. Number 2. Pole cores and pole shoe. Number 3. Pole coils or field coils. Number 4. Armature core. Number 5. Armature windings or conductors. Number 6. Commutator. And number 7. Brushes and bearings. Of these parts, the yoke, the pole core, the armature core and the air gaps between the poles and the armature core form the magnetic circuit, whereas the rest of, that is the field coils, armature windings, commutators, brushes and bearings form the electrical circuit. Number 1. Yoke. The outer frame or yoke serves two purposes. It provides mechanical support to the poles and acts as a protecting cover for the whole machine. And number 2. It carries the magnetic flux produced by the poles and hence completes the magnetic circuit. In small generators, whereas cheapness rather than weight is the main consideration, yokes are made up of cast iron, as you can see in the figure. But for large machines, usually cast steel or rolled steel is employed. Because weight is the main consideration in case of large machines, so cast steel or rolled steel is used as they have high permeability. So less material is required to generate a particular magnetic field and hence less weight. Number 2. Pole core and pole shoe. The field magnets consists of pole core and pole shoes. Pole core is usually of circular section and is used to carry the coils of insulating windings carrying the field circuit current. Pole cores are not usually laminated and made up of cast steel. The pole shoes serve two purposes. Number 1. They spread out the flux in the air gap, as you can see in the figure. And also, being of larger cross section, reduce the reluctance of the magnetic path. Number 2. They support the exciting coils. There are two types of pole construction. Number 1. The pole core itself may be of solid piece made up of either cast iron or cast steel, but the pole shoe is laminated and is fastened to the pole face by means of countersunk screws. And number 2, as you can see in the figure, in the modern design, the complete pole cores and pole shoes are built up of thin laminations of annealed steel which are riveted together under hydraulic pressure. Number 3. Pole coils or field coils. The field coils or pole coils, which consist of copper wire or strip, are former wound for the correct dimension. Then the former is removed and wound coil is put in place over the core. The object of the magnetizing or field coil is to provide, under various conditions of operations, the number of ampere turns of excitation required to give the proper flux through the armature to induce the desired potential difference. The field coils, after proper winding, are dipped into the insulating varnish and baked in an oven, which provides stiffness, mechanical strength and good insulating properties to the winding. As you can see in the figure, this is the former on which the field windings are wounded, and then after they are wounded on it, from the former the field windings are removed. Number 4. Armature core. It houses the armature conductors or coils and causes them to rotate and hence cuts the magnetic flux of the field magnets. In addition to this, its most important function is to provide a path of very low reluctance to the flux through the armature from a north pole to a south pole, as you can see in the figure. It is cylindrical or drum shaped and it is built up of usually circular sheet steel discs or laminations. It is keyed to the shaft. Usually these laminations are perforated for air ducts, which permits axial flow of air through the armature for cooling purposes. Such ventilating channels are clearly visible in the laminations in the figure here, where they are shown by the air holes. Up to diameters of 1 meter, the circular stampings are cut out in one piece. But above this size, these circles especially of such thin sections, are difficult to handle because they tend to distort and become wavy when assembled together. Hence, the circular laminations, instead of being cut out in one piece, are cut in a number of suitable sections or segments, as you can see in the figure, which form part of a complete ring. The purpose of using laminations is to reduce the loss due to eddy currents. Thinner the laminations, greater the resistance offered to the induced EMF, smaller the current, and lesser I2R loss in the core. Number 5. Armature coils or armature windings. The armature windings are usually former wound. These are first wound in the form of flat rectangular coils and are pulled in their proper shape in a coil puller. Various conductors of the coils are insulated from each other. The conductors are placed in the armature slots, which are lined with tough insulating material. Each coil consists of a number of turns of wire, each turn taped and insulated from each turns and form the rotor slot. Each side of the turn is called the conductor. There are two types of windings, lap winding and wave winding. The difference between the two is merely due to the different arrangement of the end connectors at the front or the commutator end of armature. The types of winding and the designing will be discussed later on when we will discuss the electrical machine design. Number 6. Commutator. The commutator is a form of rotating switch placed between the armature and the external circuit, and it serves the following purpose. It provides the electrical connection between the rotating armature coils and the stationary external circuit. Number 2. As the armature rotates, it performs a switching action reversion, reversing the electrical connection between the external circuit and each armature coil in turn, so that the armature coil voltages add together and result in a DC output voltage. Number 3. It also keeps the rotor or armature MMF stationary in space. The commutator essentially is of a cylindrical structure, and it is built up of wedge-shaped segments, as you can see in the figure, of high conductivity, hard-drawn copper or dope forged copper. The segments are insulated from each other by mica. The number of segments is equal to the number of armature coils. Here you are seeing the commutator, whereby it is kept in vicinity of a brush, which brushes and the bearings, which we'll be discussing next. Number 7. Brushes and bearings. The function of brushes, as you can see in the figure, we have highlighted the brushes. So the function of brushes is to collect current from the commutator and supply it to the external load circuit. The brushes are rectangular in shape and rest on the commutator. Brushes are manufactured in the variety of compositions and degrees of hardness to suit the commutation requirements. They may be classified roughly as carbon, carbon graphite, metal graphite, and copper. The allowable current density at the brush contact varies from 5 ampere per square centimeter in case of carbon to 23 ampere per square centimeter in the case of copper. The brushes are housed in brush holders, usually of box type variety, which are mounted on brush holder studs or brackets. The brushes are made to bear down on the commutator by springs, as you can see in the figure, whose tension can be adjusted by changing the position of lever in the notches. Now we are discussing the bearings. The purpose of using bearings in electrical machines is to support and locate the rotor to keep the air gap small, consistent, and transfer load from the shaft to the motor frame. The bearings enable high and low speed operations, minimizes friction, and saves power. With small machines, ball bearings may be used at both the ends. For large machines, roller bearings are used at the driving end, and ball bearings may be used at the non-driving end, that is at the commutator end. The ball and rollers are generally packed in hard oil for quieter operation and for reduced bearing wear. The main aim of discussing the construction of electrical machine was to make you visualize the parts of DC machines. And now we will show you how all these parts are assembled, and doing that we will just revise the parts that we have just discussed in brief. First, you are seeing the yoke. It is the outer cover of the DC machine. Now you are seeing the stator magnets. It provides the magnetic field which is needed for the machine. Here it is shown to have north and south poles, but generally it is made up of electromagnets. Now we are seeing the armature core. Now we see the commutator. Its main function is the collection of current, as we just discussed, and it is made up of segments, as you can see. Now we are seeing the brushes. The brushes does the collection of currents from the commutator. Now we are again assembling the machine parts, and we are forming the whole electrical machine. Thank you, my friends. If you have any questions regarding the video, you can comment it in the comment box. Please hit like and subscribe button below and support us. And stay tuned for the next lectures. My next lecture will be on DC generator working and characteristics. Thank you.